ADHD, Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder. Does this active child have ADHD? Continue with this video to learn more. You may pause or rewind at any part of this video. The significance of ADHD lies in its prevalence of about 5%. That means 5 out of 100 children have ADHD, and 2 out of a class of 40 students may have ADHD. It is the fourth highest contributor to disease burden locally, with 6% disability adjusted life year for children aged 14 and below. A Spanish study estimated high cost incurred for treatment of ADHD. In this video, you will learn how to differentiate a normal active child from an ADHD child, how to diagnose ADHD according to DSM-5 criteria, how to manage ADHD at primary care clinic, as well as when to refer.
Good morning, Mr. Shankar.
Anna,
morning to you, Ryan.
Yeah.
How are you today?
I'm very good.
Okay, all right. Okay, so what can I do for you today?
Oh, I need your help. Mm-hmm. You know Ryan since young.
Yeah.
He has been a very active boy,
mm-hmm.
but something major happened last week.
Tell me about it.
He actually pushed one of his classmates down and he got injured.
So we were called down by the school.
Right.
We had a meeting with the teacher and the parents and the boy. Everyone was very upset with him.
Right.
But thankfully, after Ryan apologized to them sincerely, the parents got pacified.
Right.
But before we left the meeting, the mother was suggesting whether Ryan may have ADHD.
Right.
I never thought about it until that moment. So I went to surf the internet about it, saw the IMH website,
right.
and they had a video clip on a boy with ADHD, and concerned Ryan may have those features.
Okay.
For example, his English teacher has complained that Ryan has been disturbing other students during class, and sometimes she has caught him reading English storybooks under his table while she's teaching. He has forgotten to hang up his homeworks on time, and sometimes he has played prank on other students also. Oh, Ryan, what are you doing?
Don't worry, I'm just playing. Not bad.
You shouldn't be doing that.
Okay, sorry.
No, it's alright. Okay. Yeah, Ryan, can you tell me what happened last week?
Last week, I was queuing up for the ABA room.
Mm-hmm.
John, my friend, was at the front of the queue.
Right.
I also wanted to go to the front of the queue, so I go and tickle him. I got really angry.
Oops.
Then he pushed me down.
Okay.
Then I also got really angry and I also pushed him back down.
Let's see.
Then I was like, why you bullying me? I also pushed him back down.
Oh.
I did not do it on purpose.
Oh, I see. But you apologized to him afterwards, right?
Yep. After I apologized, we are still very good friends
now. Alright, good to hear that. So it was an accident, right?
Yep. Thank you.
So be careful the next time you play with your friends, alright?
Yep.
Always remember safety first.
Yep, not so bad as for me.
Okay, alright. So otherwise, how is Ryan at home?
Oh, okay. He has been quite a naughty boy at times. But we are used to it. You know, mummy nags him on and off, which he doesn't like. But otherwise, he's okay. He's not the aggressive one. He doesn't get into fight with others. He doesn't play with fire or anything dangerous.
Okay.
So what happened last week was the first time something major like that.
Okay. And how is his daily work?
Oh, okay.
He loves to play games, you know? Mm-hmm. For example, he loves soccer. although he does not like to sit and study, he likes to read a lot of books.
Uh-huh. Okay.
I notice he can be messy with his things at times.
Mm-hmm.
He forgets to bring his school work.
Mm-hmm.
He sometimes does not pack up his bag.
Mm-hmm.
But when I nag him to do so, he does know where the books and stationery are.
Okay. So he does need some minor supervision.
I would say minor.
Okay. And besides the language teacher, does he have problems with the other teachers?
Actually, the other teachers have good comments for him. For example, his math teacher is happy with his performance. And his PE teacher commends him for helping to pack up his sports equipment after the games. So that's good.
You can tell me a little bit about his school results.
Oh, actually, his exam results are very good. Although he's a playful boy, he's doing well in his studies.
I'm glad to hear that. Okay, so overall, Ryan sounds like he's a normally active boy.
Okay. I do not think that he has ADHD. Yeah. But however, to be sure, I'll get some information from the school teachers, alright? So, Mr. Schenker, can I have your permission to contact the school teachers?
Yes, Dr. Lim, go ahead.
And then after that, once the report is back, I'll contact you again, alright?
Okay, alright.
So, is there anything else that can do for you today?
So, you don't really think he has ADHD? It doesn't
sound like he has ADHD.
Oh, I'm relieved to hear that, thank you. Right. Thank you very much, Dr. Lim.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you.
See you, Ryan.
Okay.
By the way, what do you want to be when you grow up?
To be a doctor!
According to the diagnostic criteria of DSM-5, Ryan fulfills only 2 symptoms for inattention. He fulfills only 4 symptoms for hyperactivity and impulsivity. Thus, Ryan is unlikely to have ADHD.
Madam Yao, and this must be John.
Yes.
Yeah, John is in primary 3 this year.
Yeah.
Yeah, how is everything in school?
Good!
Right.
Doctor, the reason why we are here is because John has taken his mid-year exam, and he passed his maths paper. But he left 6 pages blank and borderline failed all his other subjects. The school teachers and counselor have actually asked us to come here for ADHD assessment to request for more time for his PSLE.
Yeah.
I understand that the teachers have sent him their reports to you.
Yeah, that's right. So he's been assessed by the school counselor and by the reach team as well, and they have sent him the assessment reports already. So to complete the assessment, I need to understand from you about his behavior at home.
Oh yes, I made a whole. We have made a list of events that happens in school and at home.
Alright.
Probably I would like to highlight to you.
Sure, you can share now. Yeah.
Okay. At home, my husband and I could tell the difference between his older brother and him. Mm-hmm. They are only 3 years apart, but they are so different. Mm-hmm. I have no problem with his older brothers.
Right.
At his age, his brother was quite independent. He can pack his bag, do his own schoolwork. It's sometimes just occasional reminder.
Right.
And I teach him a few days before the exam, easily understood and absorb and do well.
Mm.
Unlike for John, even now at primary 3, he still behaves like a kindergarten kid. He needs so many pushing to put things down properly, to pack his bag. I have to drag him up for a bit every day to be in time for school.
Right.
He has no sense of urgency, no sense of priority. He misplaced his pencils, his water bottles, and his lunchbox. He meddles with everything he sees, and he has spoiled the washing machine and the electric oven. Keep quiet, John. Come and sit down. Go bounce the ball. Take out your storybook and read. I'm talking to the doctor. Teachers in school since primary 1 has taught me almost every month or sometimes every week for the problems that he created in school.
How about his interactions with his friends in school?
He only has one good friend. The rest are too irritated by him because he just keep peeping at what they are doing, taking their erasers and rulers. He just also complained that why can't he just stop? I mean, they're at a loss of what to do.
So it sounds like his problems have been ongoing for a while. So is there any reason why you didn't seek assessment from him?
His grandparents do not want him to be assessed. They think that he's just a normal multi kid,
right.
But they think that he's not slow. In fact, they think that sometimes he can answer questions intelligently. The doctor, the thing is that he looks perfectly normal. My friends and relatives only see him once in a while. Feels that he's just playful, lazy, extremely stubborn, and wants his own way kid. It's only if you interact with him daily that you can see the acute difference. But if without his brother, we probably would not be able to tell. You see, doctor, he loves ball games. He can play for hours and hours, but when it comes to reading or studying, within 5 minutes he will fall asleep. I am really angry about it. Even if he does not sleep, I could teach him 3 to 4 times the same thing, but he just doesn't get it. I teach his brother once and he will remember. I intend to let John stop all his ball games and channel more time and energy to study or he will fail his exam. John, wake up.
Hi.
Doctor wants to talk to you.
Hi, John.
Yeah. So can you tell me a little bit about the math paper? What did these 6 pages say?
Oh, you mean the exam?
Yeah.
It was so long. During the exam, I played with my pen, then my eraser, then my ruler and everything else on the table until there was nothing to play with. I couldn't stand it anymore. I closed my hand to go to the toilet. When I came back, I still had questions, but then now there were still 6 more pages left.
Right.
Right.
I don't like to study. I like balls and swimming. Not that my teachers in school don't like me, but my friends don't like me.
Oh yes. This year when MP comes to visit the school and host the meeting to find how the students are doing, the principal actually handpicked and select students for every level to attend. She's impressed by John because other students are quiet during the Q&A sessions, but only John puts up his hands to ask questions. He's not afraid of anything or anybody. Yeah. She also says that he asks good, unusual and creative questions.
Hey John! Yeah, sounds like a smart kid, right? Creative and you're outspoken too.
And you're sporty.
Alright. Yeah, so Madam Yao, from the information available, right, from the school's assessment, which assessment, and also from information provided by yourself, it does sound like John has ADHD. So ADHD is actually a developmental condition. So what it means is that symptoms start from young. While it may persist across the growing years, but also there's a tendency for it to improve age as well. So the thing about ADHD is that in terms of the causality, there is significant also genetic influence. So can I check with you whether if there are any relatives, including yourself and your husband, who may have similar symptoms or even been diagnosed with ADHD before?
But come to think of it, my husband is sporty kind and hands on. He cannot tolerate sitting down doing anything.
So, the children with ADHD may have some, difficulties. Particularly in the academic setting, right? So, because they are more restless and active, they may have more difficulty with sustaining their attention, right? So, they may be often labeled as bad children. But then of course, we also know of many individuals who have also managed to achieve success and overcome their difficulties despite having ADHD. Right? What about Michael Phelps?
I don't even. My mom told me all about him. He's really? My hero!
How many Olympic goals?
15. About 15.
Yeah, okay, right. So I mean, I think it's never too late to help the child. Right? So in terms of ADHD treatment, there are several approaches. The important thing I think is to teach him skills. So one of the things as adults at home and also in school, right, we need to implement what we call behavior management for him. Right? So at home, think about what are some of the routines you may want him to establish. Right? So for example, think about gadget time, and also structuring when the play time is, what time is, so that he knows what the time period is. You can also use a star charts or reward charts. Have you heard of this before?
Yes, I have.
Alright, so one of the ways is to start off the star chart. Basically to motivate him to learn one thing. So in the school, the REACH team will be working with the school teacher, school counselor, and allied educator in terms of implementing behavior strategies in the classroom to help them stay on task. Right? So some regular communication in the school also be helpful. Right. So another form of treatment, of course, will be to consider intermediating for medication. Okay, so in terms of medication, we usually use stimulant medication first. Alright. John, how? Can you swallow tablets?
Can.
Yeah, okay. The medication?
I think redoxin.
Okay.
Please give us a redoxin.
So, the medication itself, I think that because of the significant difficulties that John has, so particularly parenting stress, you want to consider it so that we can control his behavior, the ADHD symptoms, and reduce the so-called impairments of him, and also the distress to the adults.
Can you know whether it caused the hyperactivity worsen?
Okay, so the stimulant medication, actually what it means is that this medication, in terms of the impact on the brain, is that it stimulates the release of several different types of chemicals. especially this part of the week, which we know we be deficient in children with ADHD. The medication itself may have some side effects, right? So for children who are new to it, at the beginning they may experience some abdominal discomfort, distension, sometimes constipation, diarrhea. And also they may experience increase in heart rate and blood pressure. Just checking in first, does he have any fear and sleep heart problems? Or any relatives or as parents yourselves, any one with heart condition? So otherwise, the other thing about the medication is that it may reduce his appetite. And then during the initial period of treatment, the rate of height and weight gain may be slightly slower. Okay, although the eventual height and eventual weight should not be too far off his actual gain. Okay, alright. So during the period of treatment and medication, we also be monitoring his height and weight as well. So otherwise, once starting on medication, I can review again and we can discuss how to use the medication. Because sometimes, particularly if behavioral strategies work at home, some parents may then choose not to have medication during weekends and school holidays. Any questions otherwise?
Diagnosis of ADHD is clinical. John has shown at least 6 symptoms for the category of inattention for a duration of more than 6 months, to a degree that is inconsistent with his developmental level as a 12-year-old. He also has at least 6 symptoms for the category of hyperactivity impulsivity for more than 6 months, to a degree that is inconsistent with his developmental level. For the diagnosis of ADHD according to DSM-5 criteria, the answers must be yes to all the following 5 areas. First, John has at least 6 symptoms to either the inattention or hyperactivity impulsivity subgroup. Note that these symptoms are not solely a manifestation of oppositional behavior, defiance, hostility, or failure to understand tasks or instructions. For older adolescents and adults aged 17 and above, at least 5 symptoms are required. Second, John's symptoms are present prior to age 12. Third, his symptoms are present in 2 or more settings, that is, at home, in school, and at other activities. Fourth, there is clear evidence that the symptoms interfere with or reduce the quality of social, academic, or occupational functioning. Fifth, the symptoms do not occur exclusively during the course of schizophrenia or another psychotic disorder and are not better explained by another mental disorder. Example, mood disorder, anxiety disorder, dissociative disorder, personality disorder, substance intoxication or withdrawal. Thus, we can conclude that John has ADHD of predominantly combined hyperactive impulsive presentation.
Hello, Mrs. Xiao. Hello, John.
Hi.
Yeah. So how is John doing with the medication?
Oh, I've seen the change in him.
Right.
And I've jot down...
Okay, what you've observed?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, teachers reported that he's behaving better in class, less problem with disturbing other students.
Okay.
Able to concentrate better, answer questions. At home, I tried once to give him a paper to do. I couldn't imagine previously, he could not sit 15 minutes without leaving the seat and bouncing the ball.
Right.
That day, he sat for 3 hours.
Wow.
Writing and turning page by page as if he's scoring for the paper.
The onset of the medicine is about half an hour.
Right.
Duration of action is about 4 to 5 hours. But after the medicine has wear out, I can see that he starts to bounce the ball again.
Right.
For quite long, I have not allowed him to go out with relatives without my presence.
Mm.
As the trip was bound to come out to be a disaster. Last week, I allowed him to follow his uncle's family out.
Right.
And gave him the medicine beforehand. His uncle feedback to me was surprised that John seems to have gone out.
Right.
He can behave quite well, able to hold a conversation with him.
Right.
Aye.
I'm so relieved. But however, during weekends and CCA weekdays, he has job holidays. I let him play his different sports and let go of all his energy.
Right.
And enjoy himself.
Okay, John, so how do you find the brain boosting medication?
When I first took it, I felt like I had no strength at all.
Right.
I didn't feel like bouncing my ball.
Mm-hmm.
I felt drowsy,
mm-hmm.
but I couldn't sleep.
Right.
I could do my homework. I felt better after a few days. I love breakfast. Do I need to eat every day?
Well, mommy will supervise you, right? When to take the medication, okay? Alright. So sometimes for Saturdays, Sundays, if there's not too much work to be done, mommy may not give you the medication at all. Right? But you will still be able to also manage yourself and behave yourself without the medication, right? Yes?
Okay. So I'm glad that the medication actually works well for John, right? So sometimes a small percentage of young persons may not respond as well. Oh, okay. So so we'll continue to monitor John, right? And then you can also collect your feedback from me during our subsequent reviews, alright? Okay, so otherwise I'll see you again then in about 3 months time.
Okay, thank you doctor. I will continue to work on his behavior.
Okay. Alright, that's all John. Bye-bye.
In assessment, the differential diagnosis of ADHD must be borne in mind. A normal active child may not meet criteria such as pervasiveness, persistence, or functional impairment. In specific learning disorder, for example, dyslexia, dyscalculia, which is a common comorbidity with ADHD, the apparent attention difficulty of the child may be secondary to learning problem. In intellectual disability, the history of developmental delays and current adaptive behavior is lower than expected for the age of the child. IQ test may be required. In oppositional defiant disorder, the child may have recurrent pattern of negativistic, defiant, disobedient, and hostile behavior towards authority figures, which cannot be explained by mere hyperactivity or impulsivity. Whereas, conduct disorder includes more severe conduct problems and antisocial behavior. In autism spectrum disorder, there are deficits in social communication skills, restricted interests in social interaction, and repetitive routine behavior. Symptoms such as poor eye contact may be mistaken for inattention. Lastly, the taking of social history will be crucial to detect psychosocial problems as in reactive attachment disorders, personal or family conflict. Similarly, comorbidities for ADHD are specific learning disorder, oppositional defiant disorder or conduct disorder, autism spectrum disorder, intellectual disability, emotional disorders as in anger, anxiety or depression, and others, for example, tics and Tourette syndromes and substance-related disorder. This is management seen at a glance, behavioral intervention. Importantly, behavior management strategies, for example, clear rules and the use of rewards or privilege withdrawal must be implemented together with classroom behavior management and academic intervention. Parental training may also be considered at family service centers, especially for preschoolers. Or the help of parent support group, SPARC, can also be galvanized. Prescription depends on the age of the child, the severity of symptoms, the comorbidities, the efficacy and side effect profiles of the medications. Methylphenidate is commonly used. It has immediate release preparation with onset of half hour and the effect of medication lasts for about 4 hours. There are also sustained release formulations with longer onsets and durations. Methylphenidate is dosed when required. Atomoxetine requires daily dosing with a slow onset of 4 to 6 weeks. It is the alternative medicine used in ADHD patients with history of substance abuse or comorbid anxiety, tics or Tourette's disorder, or in patients who do not respond to treatment with methylphenidate. Atomoxetine can be used with caution in 5-year-olds. Both medications have comparable efficacy in 6 weeks. They are similarly contraindicated in glaucoma, hypertension, structural heart diseases, hyperthyroidism, pheochromocytoma, and other cardiovascular or cerebrovascular diseases. Both have to be followed up 3 to 6 monthly with blood pressure, height and weight measurements, with calculation of body mass index. Other medications such as bupropion, guanfacine, clonidine, and tricyclic antidepressants are rarely used. All other treatments show insufficient evidence. This is an algorithm showing a practical approach to an active child in a primary care clinic. With the information from parent or teacher, the child is assessed to see if he fulfills the DSM-5 criteria with no other mental disorder or organic diseases such as hyperthyroidism. When the diagnosis is clear, management can commence at the primary care clinic with behavioral therapy. Methylphenidate is indicated concurrently if the child shows significant impairment in function. He can be followed up in 2 weeks and subsequently 3 to 6 monthly to assess efficacy and side effects of medication with blood pressure, height and weight measurements with calculation of body mass index. If the diagnosis is unsure, a preschool child may be referred to the hospital's pediatric department or child development unit for assessment. A school-going child can be assessed by the school counselor and be referred to the REACH team, which plays an important role bridging the school counselors, the teachers, the parents, the psychiatrists, and the general practitioners. The active child who does not seem to fulfill the DSM-5 criteria can be discharged or followed up in 6 months with more information gathered from parents and teachers. When would a general practitioner be required to refer an active child to the specialist? When the diagnosis of ADHD is unsure, further assessment is required. When comorbidities like autism or learning disorders are present, further assessment or IQ testing are required. When there is contraindication in treatment, for example, if the child has family history or past history of cardiac conditions, cardiologist review is needed. When other modalities of treatment required, as in behavioral therapy with psychologist or anger management with school counselor. And finally, there is failed pharmacotherapy or complications. We have reached the end of this paper. Please refer to the notes for reference and acknowledgement. Resource materials can also be downloaded. Thank you.